Marketing Recap, Episode 2. In this episode, we're talking about Facebook taking on YouTube, how your car is influencing your purchasing decisions, and what all this means for your business. Welcome to Marketing Recap, where each week we let you in on the latest news from the world of digital marketing and talk about what it means for your business or organization. I'm BJ Smith of The Busy Marketer. And with me tonight are my co-hosts. She is the director of marketing at marketing and social media at RankLab, and the editorial director for socialmediaclub.org, Cynthia Johnson. Hey, Cynthia.
Hi. Thanks so much for the intro, BJ.
Yeah, absolutely. Short and sweet this time. And also with me is the director of content marketing at Pool Supply World and the Facebook ads expert at Arch Digital Agency, Mr. Blake Jameson. Good to see you, buddy.
Oh, how's it going?
going good. All right, I see everybody is starting to talk. So tonight is our first live show, and I want to give a shout-out to those of you who are watching us on Google+, on the Hangout, and our friends on the Twitter chat using the hashtag MRCAP. Let us know that you hear us. And before we get into our marketing news, oh, yeah, Twitter's going. I have a little...
Timothy says hi.
Hey, Timothy. One of our first and best fans, I'm sure. I have a little marketing recap news of my own. I received an email from Apple this afternoon, and the Marketing Recap podcast is now available on iTunes. There it is, right there.
All right. So
pull out your iPhones, your iPads. Right now, I made a quick link that you can use. You can go to marketingrecap.com/iTunes, and it'll take you to the podcast app or iTunes if you're on a computer. Please subscribe and leave us a rating and review. You guys are marketers who are listening to us, watching us right now. So let me put it in your terms. A review and a rating in iTunes, that's like SEO for podcasts, and it helps us to get discovered by other listeners. So it means the world to us. We have Stitcher and a few other places coming soon, so folks on Android or PCs without iTunes can join in very, very soon. All right. Our first story of the week is about the Facebook-YouTube battle that has been brewing. Facebook is making serious runs at the main leader, YouTube. Blake is going to kick us off with that story. Let's go, Blake.
Yes. So this story, or at least... the TechCrunch article that I caught was, I think, just before Christmas, so it was a little bit more than a week ago, but since our first episode was kind of recapping just 2014, I figure this is super exciting for me as a Facebook marketer specifically. I've always wanted to get into video more, and luckily with this Hangout, you know, we're getting some video content, but for the brands that I manage, I constantly produce videos, and we put them on YouTube. And it's great. It helps with SEO. We do get value out of it. But I personally just have always been drawn to Facebook. So essentially what the TechCrunch article talks about, and I'm sure we'll link that in the show notes, but Facebook is rolling out some changes where with the video content, specifically the big brand pages that have a lot of video content, are getting a special layout on their page, which essentially looks a lot like a YouTube channel, and you can have a really big video kind of at the top that is like your featured video, and then different categories or playlists or whatever underneath it. And in my experience in the past, what I've done is I've created the videos and I've uploaded them to YouTube, and then I share the YouTube link on Facebook, and my thought process is I want to keep all my views in one place, so I want to get my Facebook traffic, you know, on one of the main pages I manage called Pool Supply World. We have 100,000 fans. So I'm thinking, okay, 100,000 fans, if I can get some of those to come over to YouTube and subscribe or just be a video view or a comment or any kind of engagement, then that's going to be good for our brand. But in actual application, when I share a YouTube video on Facebook, it just doesn't get the organic reach that I'm looking for. And I have no problem paying for... promoting a post to get more exposure. In fact, that's one of the main things that I talk about in the last episode. But what I've noticed is that, you know, if I'm paying to promote a YouTube video, even a couple things. Number one, it's got no chance of autoplaying in the newsfeed, which as a marketer I want that, if I can have it. The picture looks really small. The thumbnail is really small for a YouTube video, and then it's got the description. And then if you click play, it'll expand in the news feed or on the timeline, and it will play fine. But it's not kind of the ideal customer experience. And with the Facebook videos, organically, I guess, it's a lot more seamless. The videos, it makes a really big real estate. If it's coming from either a personal profile or a verified page, or Facebook kind of subjectively says, you know, some other organizations like sports teams or news outlets, they can autoplay videos. So it's just super exciting. So what I'm actually doing with that is I'm taking all of my YouTube content that I've created. I've probably created 20 to 25 videos for that Pool Supply World brand specifically, and I'm taking the MP4 MOV file and I'm uploading them to Facebook organically. So I've got my videos in two places, but I just started doing this week, and already like the reach is phenomenal compared to any time I share a YouTube video. So when you upload a video, it's going to share to Facebook as if you're posting it right then, which makes sense. But that kind of is keeping me from uploading all 25 videos at one time to just kind of get my playlist. What I want to do is I'm going to drip those out every single day for the next probably 2 weeks. And then at the end of 2 weeks, I'm going to have a lot of cool video content on Facebook. And when that new layout rolls out to every single page, then we'll be able to capitalize on that. Take advantage. And another thing that I noticed just today, I'll pull up the stats just so I make sure and get it right. I saw another video that was in my news feed that was just a really cool video, and it had to do with the swimming pool industry, and it was already popular. So I went ahead and just shared it onto my page, and it was a video that had been naturally or, you know, organically uploaded to Facebook, like I'm talking about. And the reach right now, it was shared earlier today, is 21,766 people. This was not something that I boosted. This wasn't even my content. So to put it in perspective, we have 100,000 fans. And normally, if I share something without boosting it, we might get 2,000 people reached organically. So to see a 10x lift on organic reach from a piece of content that wasn't even mine, I'm just curating somebody else's content, that's really like what a marketer could only dream about. Like you don't usually get 10x improvement.
That's crazy. Period,
you know.
That's yeah. So, that really is amazing.
Yeah, and maybe in the show notes I can link these videos because yesterday I shared another one which was one I produced, didn't get as much reach because it just wasn't that kind of type of shareable content, but it was more informational and it still got more reach than any other non-promoted post of ours lately. Yeah, I mean, so, I mean, that kind of sums it up. I don't know. I mean, like I told you kind of before the show, beyond that one brand, I'm going to take these videos and be putting them on my personal fan page to get some more exposure and really just try and get into more video production because I think video is huge in the future of social media.
You know, we've already seen so much happening since this summer, I think, when a lot of the Facebook changes were coming about. Facebook is actually, I mean, I think in the last quarter we started seeing where the views were higher for Facebook videos than YouTube. They're actually starting to take over. A lot of the statistics that are coming out right now, they're still showing how YouTube has, in 2014, so much higher viewership rate. But what it doesn't take into account is that a lot of these changes with the autoplays and things like that really didn't take place until, I think it was late summer, July, August, September time frame.
Mm-hmm.
So, Blake, all right, if somebody's out there who's a small business and they're starting to produce video content, you know, what steps would you take? Are you telling them, should they start off going with YouTube and moving to Facebook? What advice would you give?
Sure. So kind of to preempt that, I recently saw a really cool article by Gary Vaynerchuk, which again we can put in the show notes, and he talks about how people are doing video wrong. And in the article, I don't want to misquote it, but essentially what he says is brands before, you know, in 2013, 2014, have already started saying, okay, we're going to start allocating more of our digital marketing budget to videos. We're going to put in more marketing, more dollars into videos. But for a lot of the marketers out there, what that translates to is they're just dumping more money into pre-roll ads on YouTube. And Gary is extremely against this. I am moderately against this. I think that it has its place. But the reality is those little pre-roll videos are freaking annoying. If I'm going to YouTube and I want to watch something, I'm hovering my mouse over the little skip ad area, unless it's like insanely funny or really catchy. Like, it's really rare that I'll watch a whole pre-roll. And I think a lot of people are like that. Now, on the advertiser side, you don't actually pay for that view unless they watch 15 seconds. So it doesn't really matter, you know, if I'm giving an ad and you're seeing it, BJ, and then you click skip, you know, after the 5 seconds or whatever that time is, I don't get charged for it from a financial standpoint. But, you know, if you're seeing my brand and it's Blake Jameson and I'm getting in the way of something that you want to do, I'm gonna kind of put a bad taste in your mouth. You know, like, it's gonna be not necessarily the best brand equity for me. So what Gary talks about in the article and what I 100% agree with is that instead of looking at it like, okay, we need to put more budget into advertising and distribution of our videos, I think that brands, small and large, need to put in more effort and resources into the production itself of quality content. And when I say, like, production, putting money into production, I don't necessarily mean you don't have to go out and buy, like the nicest camera. You don't have to have professional lighting. You can shoot the stuff on a cell phone, but the idea is putting the resources, as in like the time to create content that people actually want to listen to. It helps, you know, betters the world. I think it's like every 10 seconds, 100 hours of footage is uploaded to YouTube or something. It's insane how much footage is always getting dumped on. So I think that it's really important, whether you have a library of videos or not, or you're just creating your first video, that you just try and focus on making your video as helpful as possible to your target audience. And that can mean a lot of different things to a lot of brands. And then once you have that video, I don't think that there's any harm in putting it on YouTube and Facebook. They're two different channels. They have two different audiences, and they have two different benefits. On the YouTube side of things, videos show up really well in search engine results for SEO stuff, which can be super helpful, whether it's for e-commerce or digital products or just building your audience. On the Facebook side, it's really a good kind of, it's combating the diminishing organic reach. And then if you put a little bit of budget on Facebook, the reach is amazing. And I think what Facebook is trying to do, and this is just me totally speculating, but because they're trying to challenge YouTube and Google, that's the obvious part. I think because of that, they are just giving videos more attention, more reach, and more promotion. So if you're putting marketing dollars into a Facebook post that is either a link post or an image post, and then you put the same amount of dollars into a video post, from what I've seen so far, the video post is going to far and wide just knock the other two out of the park in terms of organic reach. And then circling back to, if you have that great content that people want, then you're building your audience, and it's legitimate, and you're not doing it off of, you know, pre-rolls on cat videos. You're doing it on stuff, and they're liking it, and then they're sharing it with their friends. So I don't know. That's yeah.
Oh, look, hey Blake, I've got a question from the audience. Timothy Lanning wants to know, is there a timeline? I know you mentioned that this was starting to roll out. Is there a timeline on these new Facebook video tools? They sound perfect for a client of his.
Sure. So I've got the Facebook announcement pulled up right now, and I could put that in the show notes as well. Let me see here. So they basically just say they're going to roll it out in early 2015 to everyone. So it's really frustrating personally as a Facebook marketer, because I feel like I have so much opportunity on Facebook and I'm the last to get every single change.
You know, I hear that very often.
Right. But what I think is important, Timothy, is that you don't have to have the new Facebook layout features to benefit from video on Facebook. So you can And I think it's important that you start building that content library or producing content and putting it out as quickly as possible, because people eventually, you know, are going to listen to the show and then they're going to catch on, or they're going to read it somewhere. You know, everyone's catching on to videos, a trend. So I think the sooner you can get started, regardless of if you have those changes, do it.
Yeah, and I think you brought up a pretty good point about the type of production quality that we're seeing. There are some really good tools out there, and I'm going to give you guys a little bit of advice. Let me see. I don't actually have it close to me. But you know, this is what I shoot a lot of my video on. I actually have a HD camera, but this makes it a lot easier. I have a stand that goes with the tripod. Bring in some studio lights that give it a decent glow, mm-hmm. And you can, and a good mic. As a matter of fact, one of my Christmas presents. Nice new mic, and you guys can actually produce some fairly decent video quality that would really help with your business. Cynthia, do you have anything that you want to add, or any questions going on in the chat room?
No, yeah, I'm trying to keep up with everyone in the Twitter chat.
It's awesome.
I would like to add that I also feel like I'm the last to get everything, so maybe you're not the last, like you're the second to last. No, but the video content is excellent, and we saw this, you know, when Google bought YouTube, is when I think people really started paying attention to video, and Facebook's been trying to catch up ever since. The same way that Google Plus is trying to catch up with Facebook's natural ability to keep people engaged. And let's watch them battle it out, and hopefully we'll get an opportunity sooner than later to be participating in that battle.
Very cool.
Yeah. Mark Shaw says he's already using it. I think he's talking about the video stuff, which is awesome. Gina Vera says that most people don't take the time. The problem is that most people are eager to push content without taking the time. I think that's 100% true. Oh. But on the flip side, I think, and I tweeted back to her, that I think that's actually that's a great thing, is that if everyone was doing video right, then it would be really hard to stand out. But the fact that, you know, most people aren't, that's great news for the people that are just willing to put in the time.
Says the man with the green screen in his background.
No, I absolutely agree on that so much. And I would also like to point out that, you know, you see a lot of people who throw out video content and they write whatever they wish it was about and not necessarily mm-hmm. what it is about. And I don't know how Facebook will treat this, but I know that YouTube is just deleting accounts and the associated business page with it. So I'd love to see.
That's intense.
Yeah, so
it's like you're talking about clickbaiting for videos.
Oh yeah, so yeah, it's an automated system that will basically, if it flags you, then it runs a scan on your page, and if it flags you again, it removes the page and it removes the Google Plus account associated with that page.
Wow, that could be pretty detrimental.
So yeah, so don't do that. Be honest about what you're putting out there, please.
All right. Well, our next story, CES, the Consumer Electronics Show, is going on right now. But there were some companies that actually let the cat out of the bag for what they were planning to present prior to the show. And Cynthia has one of those stories that could affect some of your marketing decisions in the near future.
Yes, so I am going to be discussing OnStar announced, and make sure I am 100% correct on the term, and it's called At Your Service. So General Motors is doing an At Your Service connected car service. So, for instance, if you are looking, and I'll just throw out the number I got from the press release, 35 million people, you know, a day looking for direction somewhere. You put in your directions, it'll immediately send you ads. but good ads, deals. They know you're going there, you know you're going there, and so you're getting these discounts, which is, when I first saw it, aside from the being connected to the vehicle, thought it's, for instance, Foursquare, I always check in places, or when I was leaving so that people wouldn't know that I'm there. And I would get this deal. I'm like, well, that doesn't help me because I'm leaving now. So that's an interesting concept. The second thing that's interesting about it is that they said that they will also be selling audiobooks in the near future on the same system, and that opens the door for lots of different things. Maybe it's the new revolutionary way to sell music, to sell books. Obviously, you have location-based ads that are running. You also have podcasts. Hopefully, we wouldn't charge you guys for that, but it's revolutionizing the way that we are connected by keeping us connected and knowing where we are even when we are in motion. An example of this is also with Spotify. They partnered with Uber. So I don't know how many of you use Uber, and if you have ordered a car and gotten a little pop-up that says, please connect your Spotify so that you can continue listening in your ride, wherever it is you're going. I get that. And right, and the thing about Spotify, it's social. It's social media. I mean, you sign up with Facebook, you have shared playlists, you have audiobooks, self-help books. I mean, I would love to put up a social media book for you guys tomorrow. It's all this information that the more shares it gets, the more it appears in your playlist, and now it's playing everywhere. So again, Spotify partnered with Uber, Volvo, and Ford. And then you have General Motors coming out with, the new OnStar at Your Service app, which, you know, it sounds revolutionary, but I think what they did is they added a check-in to the ideas and the partnerships strategically already happening. And as a marketer, you think, how do I get in on this, right? Just like the video, I don't have $400,000 to create this epic video web series for my company, and I don't have the money to spend with advertising in the early stages of this General Motors tool. But what you do know is that things like Spotify are partnering with companies that have a huge reach. Why not focus your attention on creating shared playlists in your community? Make your accounts more important. Give them direction. You have something to say, or you wrote a book, put it on audio, stick it on one of these sites, and go with the flow, you know. But don't just quit because it sounds bigger than you. It's not. Mm-hmm. They just make it sound that way because, you know, right. It's CES Las Vegas. It's not big. It's not worth it. Yeah. So really putting yourself out there and knowing that there are ways to get in early without taking out, you know, a loan to cover a mortgage. So. I don't know if anybody has any questions.
Yeah, so...
the general consensus... I'm sorry, Blake.
I was reading a question from Claire Wyatt. I'm not sure if it's about the car stuff. I think it is. He said it makes it easy, but thinking the check-in thing is dead except for Facebook a little bit. I think it's true. I don't know. I was actually just talking to somebody today about Swarm, which is like Foursquare's new app. I just haven't really gotten into it. Yeah, I mean, I kind of agree. I don't really use the check-in stuff. I will put tags on like my Instagram. I think Instagram's getting huge. And I have no idea if there's any opportunity for Instagram to get into that automobile business.
Yeah.
That might be really interesting. That's probably the place I check in, but I'm really good about it. Where if I post a picture, I'm at the office or I'm at the beach, I'll put that location, and then it's on my map in my Instagram. So,
yeah, you know, one of the things that really kind of strikes me about this this new deal, this new OnStar service, is when you want to go somewhere. In the past, you push a little OnStar button. And you actually talk to a live person who will say, you know, hey, where do you want to go? And they, you know, here's the directions, we're going to send you there. Or they'll plug in something, they'll plug in the address, and then automatically push the turn-by-turn directions to you. And it sounds like this new system, they're actually having search capabilities in there. So there's actually, room for local search, local SEO kind of stuff. I think there are actually brands that are getting in there ahead early, mm-hmm. that are getting the automatic nod from OnStar. And, you know, I think it's going to be something interesting for brands. I hate to think that it's going to be another place that they have to submit their information to. You know, why don't you just use Google? You know, we do all that work to satisfy Google with our local results. You know, why doesn't OnStar just use that?
Yeah.
You
know, I just had a thought, too, Cynthia, about another way. I love your idea of creating Spotify playlists that your audience is going to resonate with so they can take it with them. You know, when they're in the car or whatever, or in their Uber.
Yeah, well, and it keeps your brand connected.
Right.
Super connected.
Right. And I was just thinking, you know, because, again, I'm a very big proponent of paid advertising when the opportunity is right. So maybe that means, you know, looking at the brands that are integrating with this new smart car like Spotify and maybe try and get on the wave of advertising your brand on Spotify. I'm not sure if you can do that geo-targeted, but, you know, if I have a business here in Phoenix and then I hit up Spotify and do a media buy and say I want to advertise on Spotify for the next, you know, 60 days in the Phoenix area, they're going to take my money. And if now that means that people are going to hear their stuff, you know, when they're in the car, maybe I have a restaurant or a nightclub and then they hear, you know, an ad about that. Who knows? I don't know. I think there's a lot of interesting things that I think marketers will do with that.
Yeah, and you know what else? I think, I don't know who said it, if you can remind me the name, that checking in is dead.
Claire.
So yes, Claire, I think you're right. It's dead in the sense that people aren't checking in to check in anymore. They're doing it without even realizing that they're doing it. So Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, everywhere that you go, if you're asking driving directions and, you know, it's sending you ads for exactly where you want to go, it's like you just checked in. They didn't call it checking in. They called it directions. And we've been checking in longer before checking in existed, and mm-hmm. we'll continue to do so as, you know, geo-targeted location-based apps and tools are created.
Yeah. I know Android users, sorry to interrupt, but Android users are getting tracked, like, all the time. Like, there's a Google, like, a website, and again, I'll find it. We'll put it in the show notes. But if you have an Android phone and you're signed into Google+, you can go to the special website, and you can see where you've been in the last, you know, any day. You can just see your path of where you went all day just because your phone is just always connected. And it's creepy. Like, in the use case in some cases that I've seen, it's like, you know, spouses spying on their significant other to be like, well, where did you really go to the store? And then, you know, like, it's some weird kind of big brothery stuff. But it's, you know, like you said, it's not called checking in necessarily, but you're just, it's always checked in.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and I think I hear what people are saying about that SEO benefits too. You know, oh, that's great for SEO, but then I think, well, you know, all these other sites have, you know, location-based posting. I think the difference that you hit on, BJ, is that you're just asking for directions. You don't even realize that you're boosting anyone's SEO at this point, you know?
Well, you know, one of the things that they talked about is it's not necessarily, okay, I expect directions if I say, you know, take me to the nearest Starbucks, right? But if I say, I want to find a local coffee shop, you know, then at that point, OnStar determines which coffee shop they send you to. It's not necessarily that, hey, if they've got a deal with Starbucks, they're going to send you to a Starbucks, but there might be one that's 2 miles closer to you that would do the job just as well.
Right. I mean, yeah, and that's kind of like Spotify. Like, when you're just playing a radio, why does the next song come on? What is it that you've listened to before, listened to after? Who are you friends with, and who are they partnered with? And that's, you know, could be the answer of why you're getting the information you're receiving. In fact, I've been in an Uber, so Google invested in Uber's mapping technology, correct? And so they also own Waze, but they have Google Maps. And the Uber drivers are supposed to use the mapping system, the direction system, powered by Google. Well, I've had Uber drivers with two phones, one with the mapping that they need to have, and one with Waze open, mm-hmm. because the mapping that they're supposed to use takes the longer route, and all of these people were getting mad because their GPSs were giving them shorter distances. So as you said, you know, where are these computers taking us? I don't know.
I asked the question in the chat. Would you use? Actually, I put use, but it was supposed to be, would you use OnStar for in-car audiobooks, nav, and music versus your smartphone? You guys have any thoughts on that?
I wouldn't.
I would rather, yeah, I would rather, if I had to have one hub, I'd rather it be my smartphone.
You know, I am
dying. Because I'm not always in the car.
Yeah, I'm dying to get a get the Apple Car, what is it called, CarPlay, installed in my GTI. I think that thing is awesome. You know, it connects right there to my iPhone, and it's got my podcast on there. It's got Pandora on there. It's got my navigation, you know, the maps that I want to use. I don't know. No, I like it based on the smartphone.
I agree, and I have a lease, this like Jetta lease, and you know they give you the SiriusXM for 3 months, and then they'd call you for like 20 years after. I'm like, I already gave the car back, and you still want me to pay you SiriusXM. Yes, I don't necessarily think that the paid media, you know, what OnStar is doing is reversing who's paying them, which is probably a very smart idea.
Okay. All right. Do you guys have any other last comments before we start wrapping up?
No, I'm just scanning Twitter. I think.
Hi, Claire. I know I recognize the name.
Are you scouting for GM?
Are you scouting for GM? No.
Yeah. How deep do advertising algorithms run in services like Spotify, et cetera? Do they factor in the actual function? So that's a good question. So Tim asks, and I'll say it louder. I was talking to myself. So Tim asks, how deep do the advertising algorithms run in services like Spotify? Do they factor in the actual function? So I think what he means is, do they know that you're in a car that's moving, I guess, for those ads? That's a really good question, and unfortunately I'm not a CES, so I can't ask them. Cynthia?
I know a little bit. I know, so if you connect it to the car, it knows that you're connected to a car.
Cool. And then, you know, I know because Spotify was plugged into Facebook, they're actually one of the first people that kind of ruined that little Blake's listening to, you know, Papa Roach for the eighth time, you know, or whatever. But they kind of ruined it after Zynga with the Farmville stuff. But anyways, they have all that Open Graph data, so they do know anything that's public, Spotify is going to know on Facebook. But yeah, if they know that you're moving in the car, that's pretty cool.
Okay. All right. Well, I want to thank everyone for your time today. I want to thank all our friends over in the Twitter chat at hashtag MRCap. I want to thank folks for our questions within the Google Hangout. And thanks for everybody who is watching us live. And again, to all you guys who are listening to us in the future on iTunes, we will be available. This episode will actually be available come on Monday on iTunes, and it will be live on YouTube with all our show notes. We're going to gather a little bit more information. There were some stories that we came across this week that we did not talk about tonight, but we will put links to those in the show notes, so you guys will actually have access to what we think are the biggest things going on this week. And that's going to wrap up this episode of Marketing Recap. Blake, why don't you let the folks know how they can get in touch with you?
So at Blake Jameson. Jameson is Jameson, and it's that on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, anything.
And Cynthia, how about you?
So on Twitter, it's at Cynthia Live, and I've actually will have added anyone participating in the Twitter chat to a Twitter list. The Twitter list is called Marketing Recap. If you'd like to find people that you met during the chat or just kind of keep up to date on what's going on with everyone in this community, you can subscribe to that Twitter list. You can also email me anytime at cynthia@socialmediaclub.org or cynthia@ranklab.com.
Thanks, Cynthia. And as for me, you can find me on Twitter at BJSmithStrategy or TheBusyMarketer.com. And come check out my show, The Busy Marketer Podcast. I'll be kicking off a new season shortly. You can find me on most places that have podcasts, iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, a few other places. Remember to join us next Thursday for the live show at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific. You can find out more and get links and reminders at marketingrecap.com. I created a new little page that went up today that's marketingrecap.com/episode-preview. And usually before the show that will go up, it will have a link to the Hangout. It will have links to several of the articles, the stories that we're talking about this week. And if you can't make it to the live show, you know, we're going to be there on iTunes, YouTube, and a few other places. So come check us out. And like I said, please leave us a review. That means the world to us. See you guys next week.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.